Good morning, church. I'm Darlene Johnson-Cargill, and it's my honor to be your liturgist this morning. I'd like to welcome those who are here in the sanctuary and those who are with us online. And if you can, would you please stand and join me in the call to worship? Lord, lead us in ways that lead us to life. Free us to love as completely as you love. Help us find our worth, not by lifting ourselves above others, but by accepting that we belong to you. May our fulfillment be found not in what we hold on to, but in what we freely give in your name. Free us to live without fear, following wherever your Holy Spirit leads us. Amen.
Good to be together, and it's good to be able to pray with and for one another. In just a moment, we'll have an opportunity to share ways in which we can pray. And if you're worshiping online or here in the sanctuary, you can always submit prayer requests to prayer@garfieldchurch.org. That information is in the bulletin and on our website. But it's such an important way that we connect to God. And so Craig McGaughey has a microphone. If you have something you'd like to share, a way we can celebrate, a way we can pray, raise your hand. He'll come around with a microphone. Just let us know your name and how we can pray today. So are there ways that we can pray with and for one another?
I would, again, like prayers for my wife, Gail. She continues to have problems as her hearing sight diminish. Thank you.
Prayers for Gail. We want to continue to keep in prayer all those suffering the after effects of the incredible weather we had on Tuesday. There may be some in this room who still are without earthly power, but the good news is we have power from above, no matter what.
I'd like to offer a praise to God. As you know, we have a lot of young people help us with the music here. And again, in the fall, we're going to be having more of the teenagers provide us their gift of God. And we thank God for those incredible children.
Yes. Praise God.
Great. He's coming.
Good morning. Yeah. Good morning, church family. My name is Bridget Rogers. I attended this church maybe about a decade ago for years, and I worked on the renewal of your capital campaign at Land Under Payment, obviously head of the decorations. And then I moved to Florida, and I came back due to having to fill in for Eliza Bryant Village as the new CEO and director. But I came here this morning, and Francis Blount is a very good friend of mine, because in my absence, what I paid forward, this is how good our God is, what I paid forward working on that committee for your capital campaign came full circle back to Eliza Bryant Village, which closed the nursing home in June of 2022. And this wonderful, miraculous choir, looking right at you too, gave, they knew they sold the transportation buses when they closed the nursing home. So your church, this wonderful, wonderful church that I always believed in, gave a generous donation to my seniors at Eliza Bryant Village, there's 150 of them, and so that they can get to their appointments and their lifestyle. So I just, my prayer today is that you continue to be the beacon of light, because you never know what you're doing when you're paying it forward. And we love you guys for that, and I just wanted to personally come and say thank you this morning.
Thank you very much. Praise God. Let's turn to God. Lord, no matter what's going on in the world and in our lives, there's always so much to praise you for, and we've done that as we've lifted our voices with our wonderful choir. And yet there's always also suffering and hardship, and so we pray for comfort for those who are grieving and suffering and those in need of healing. God, we know that you're a good, good God, and that you are always ready to listen and hear our prayers and respond. So God, we thank you for the gift of community, the gift of being able to work together to serve and love your world. And so we just come before you today, humbly, looking to hear a word from you that we might be transformed more and more into your Son, and help us in all the ways, large and small, because nothing is too small for you, Lord. You're the God of the mustard seed. So we are grateful that you have placed us together, and we join our voices in that spirit, saying the prayer that you model for us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have an opportunity to support the mission and ministry that God does through Garfield Memorial Church, through each of you. We've heard a testimony of the power of generosity already, and know that whatever you give, however you give, helps to widen the circle, helps to connect diverse people who share a common brokenness with our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we thank you for that. If you're new here, we don't expect you to give. We want you to simply come and experience the love of Christ together. But know that if you are a regular attender or a member, everything you give makes a huge difference. And we've appreciated the second mile gifts that we've received this summer to help us catch up from a rough financial start to the year. And we continue to welcome those extra second mile gifts this summer and beyond. It's easy to give online. You can just go to garfieldchurch.org/giving. You can give by text. It's in your bulletin if you're here in person. It's on the website if you're online. And we try to make it simple so you can even set up a recurring gift and forget about it, and it will just go through. But we are grateful for that. If you are new, we hope to go to new@gmc.org. We have a fun survey, a little gift, a little surprise that will come afterwards, and it's a way for us to stay in touch. We send out weekly e-notes from the pastors and other things about upcoming events and opportunities to get connected here at Garfield. And speaking of that, we have Rock the Block in South Euclid. It's a big festival in the South Euclid community coming up on August 24th. And we're looking for volunteers, so if that's something that interests you, there's information in your bulletin and on the website. And we want to go out and support this great celebration community event. And also, a couple weeks ago, Pastor Chip did a little tease about some yard signs that were coming that will help us to love our neighbor. And we have them today. You may have noticed when you came in. But we want to cover Cleveland with love. And in this series about high dives, take a leap of faith and put one in your yard, take some for friends, you can grab them on your way out. It's a great way in this divided time, especially with the election. Does anybody know there's an election coming? Yeah, so it's a little bit divided, but we want to say we love everybody, and everybody is a beloved child of God, so make sure to get these on your way. So let's continue to worship God by the giving of our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
Thank you.
receive these offerings, these gifts that come from you. Use them to your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning again. Our Bible reading this morning is from Luke 5th chapter, verses 1 through 11. You may follow along in your bulletin. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and a crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gotten out of them and were washing their nets. He got onto one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boats. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to burst. So they signaled their partners in the boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down to Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were astounded at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him.
Good morning again.
I'm happy to do what I tell everybody else to. Turn the mic on. Chip, you lost your point. You could have told me to turn my mic on. It's a very special day for some members of our congregation. They are going to be celebrating their 67 years of marriage. That's Lauren and Helen Gisela. And we are blessed that they're able to be in church today, so we're going to sing Happy Anniversary to Lauren and Helen. The choir will help you, but I think you know the tune. Very bad. Thank you.
There we go. Of course, God was not going to let me get away with Craig forgetting me not. We're singing that song. I love Winston Churchill, and you know everybody always tried to put Churchill in his place, but you never really could. He always got the last word. And I'll never forget one story that was told. He came into a big cathedral to make a speech, and the person introducing him wanted to take a little shot at him. So he got up and he drew a chalk line about 7 feet up on the board, on the wall, and he said, "Hey, it's been said that our prime minister has drank so much brandy that it could have filled this entire cathedral right up to that line." And he sat down, and Churchill got up and he looked at that line, and then he looked up at the ceiling. He says, "So little time. So much left yet to do." Man, 67 years? Gosh, Terry, 36, we're rookies. So little time. So much left yet to do.
It flies by.
What's that?
It flies by.
Yeah, ask Helen. I'm just saying. All right, ask Terry. All right. Anyhow, God bless you both. You've been such an important part of my life and of this church. I was thinking of that too. I was talking at a recent church meeting. You know, they talk a lot in Cleveland about our diversity as being this most diverse church, and usually it comes down to ethnicity. That's so obvious, but I would say if it walks in Cleveland, it walks in Garfield. I mean, it goes across all kinds of lines. But what I haven't been celebrating enough, and I've spent a lot of time on this year, is our intergenerational diversity. We have six generations in this church. Scholars say most churches have three. Just from builders to boomers to Gen X to millennials I've been spending a lot of time with, to Gen Z that we've got some activities coming up for Gen Alpha that's in our children's ministry. Do you know in this church we are discipling right now 22nd century kids? That's who they're going to be. They're going to be 22nd century leaders. And it's powerful. So we got something coming up. We've been spending time with millennials. If you know, millennials are the largest group population-wise in America. They make up the majority of the adult workforce in our country. Boomers like me and builders, we have bias toward them because I continue to call them kids. Because they are my kids. But I've been taught by them, like, yeah, I'm 42 years old. I have two teenage daughters. Quit calling me a kid. I run this at the Federal Reserve. And it was interesting. When we started doing these Millennial Mondays, I think the first one, we had 47 millennials come out. We had 31 children. We had to hire 4 child care workers. I mean, it's been revelatory. But they got something fun coming up. It's real fun. You'll see it in your, I think it's in our announcements there at the bottom right corner. It looks like the Browns. But they plan an all-church event. They're going to kind of run it. They're picking up the mantle, producing it. Terry and Flora and I. They're calling it Tailgate Sunday. It's an all-church gathering, fellowship across generations. So what you have to do that Sunday, wear your favorite team shirt, whatever it is, high school, college, pros. We had a millennial cookout, and I saw one of the couples, they're part of our leadership, they had this cornhole thing, and one was University of Toledo, and one was Bowling Green. I said, "What's up with that?" And the husband said, "Well, I went to Bowling Green, she went to Toledo, so every time we play, it's a grudge match." So there'll be some of that out there. There'll be food trucks. There'll be inflatables. There'll be just time for fellowship. There'll be some cool mission things to do. We're buying devotionals for all of our teachers. They're just educators. Different devotionals. And we're going to have them out there for teachers or educators to come pick up. And we want you and McGrath's House of Prayer. There'll be some cards there. If you want, just write a personal card. Maybe leave your email and say, "Hey, I just want you to know. I'm going to be praying for you for 30 days for the first month of school." Secondly, we partner with Building Hope in the City. They do some real great work with immigrants. Cleveland is still a gateway city. And so paths to citizenship, Building Hope in the City helps them with that. There's a citizenship book that's $23. There are citizenship flashcards for them to pray that are $13. And we're going to try to build 50 packs. Between Rock the Block and our tailgate, they need 100. So we'll be out there. If you want to buy a book for $23, the church is going to buy the flashcards for $13. And you can have cards there to write a little welcome for immigrants. Welcome to our country. Welcome to Cleveland. We're praying for you at Garfield Memorial Church. So look for that. It's going to be a fun day. I'm not sure if I'm going to wear my Colgate gear that I can't fit in anymore, or buy some and act like I actually used to wear it, or bronze. I'm not sure. I'm praying about it. Probably going to be Colgate. Hope runs eternal. Anyhow, so keep that on. I hope you'll stay. It's going to be a fun day. So we're in this series. Pastor Steve kicked us off last week, called High Dive. I hope you've seen the graphic for this. It's on our website, in our e-notes and that. It's just a picture of a little boy looking over a high dive, right? And man, that brings back memories, doesn't it? And we're talking about taking the plunge. We've talked a lot about faith and discipleship, but what about risky faith? What about jumping off the high dive? We always hear talk about, what, a leap of faith. And when I thought about that series, I knew where Pastor Steve was going last week. But the first thing that came to my mind was this call story of the first disciples, as Luke tells it. Luke shows up, and it's a call to what? To go into deep water. Now, there's a lot of rites of passage in our lives, but if any of you grew up as children and you were at all involved in going to a swimming pool, one of the rites of passage were what? Going from the shallow water into the deep water. You remember that little rope with the little floaties on it, right? What was that? That was a line of demarcation. It was like the neutral zone between South and North Korea, you know? And you looked out there, and you were a kid, I don't know, five, six, seven years old. You were trained to stay in the shallow water. And you looked out there, and it was just ominous, right? It was, what happens in the deep water? What am I going to do? Jesus comes across these fishermen. They're washing their nets after an overnight crisis. Now, some of here have traveled to Israel, my wife and I, some we've taken two trips out of Garfield, have been there five times. There's a wonderful spot where the actual warm water naturally hits the Sea of Galilee. And they'll tell you that at this place, the fishermen would all come into that warm water, and that's where they'd wash their nets. So if you didn't catch anything, everybody's gonna see, right? Not that we compare, especially on social media. But, you know, Jesus sees these guys who have had an overnight crisis. And when I go to that place in Israel, I would sit there and reflect and say, where are the times where, you know, I tried so hard, I had the expertise, I thought something would accomplish, but I came in with an empty net. Put a lot of time, a lot of effort, and still. I've loved watching the Olympics this year. I'm real glad I got Peacock so I can stream it. There are ungodly hours where some of us work during the day. But I've watched it, and yesterday my wife and I streamed the American, the men's and the women's 4x400. It was so great. I was a cop. I get real patriotic during the Olympics, not all other times, but I do that. And cheer a lot for the American team, and we won gold in both. But my heart really went out to the women's Jamaican team, and all kudos to my Jamaican sister in the back of the room. But, you know, they trained so hard, and it was a bump into somebody. If you saw it, they dropped the baton, and they were disqualified. They were in second place, probably a sure bet for the silver. And afterwards, you saw those young women, you know, being positive with each other, supporting each other, but a lot of tears. And you want to say, well, that's just a race. It's just a game. You know, well, tell somebody like that it's just a job. You know, I was in youth ministry a long time. Tell a teenager, oh, when their first breakup happens, oh, it's just a little puppy love. There'll be more. You know how many suicides happen because of those first breakups? Don't trivialize things. In those moments when we thought we'd catch something, when we thought all our work would pay off, and we get hit by something that has us toiling all night. That's what Peter said, we've been laboring all night. That's when Jesus comes. He comes right into those situations. And he says to them, let's go out deeper. Let's go out deeper for another catch. This is where Jesus is being a wonderful counselor. He basically says, I know you're hurting, but we're not going to fix things here in shallow water. We're going to not fix it with shallow thoughts. We're not going to fix it around shallow people. Let's go out in deeper water. See, what a wonderful counselor. If you ever been through counseling, and I have, and continue to keep one on speed dial, you know, when you go to a counselor and you're going through a crisis or stress or difficulties, right? What does a counselor try to do? Let's get beneath the waves. Let's get down a little deeper. Let's see what's going on. You know, it may seem dangerous. It may seem unknown, but that's where good things happen. And I remember, I was thinking about this deep water, and I remember we had a place up on Lake Chautauqua growing up, and we would love to go up there weekends in the summer and, you know, fishing and did a lot of water skiing. And my oldest sister's in heaven, so she's probably going to throw a lightning bolt at me. But my sisters are 13 and 9 years older than me, so I have 3 moms. I think Marilyn was, 25, 26, and I was 13 years younger, so I'm 12 or 13. Don't tell your 12 or 13 precocious little brother that you're afraid of deep water when you jump out in there to take the, you know, the line to go water skiing, right? And back then we didn't have the big vest. Remember those little belts you had on? And you could just slide right through them. It was really wonderful. How did we survive? No car seats, no seat belts, no life vests. I'll never forget the first time I went water skiing. I was very young, I was like 8. It's my first time. We were out with some of my dad's business people. He said, lean over, said, don't embarrass me. Don't let go of the line. I said, okay, Dad. I started to get up, fell straight down, didn't let go of the line, dragged me for about 50 feet. I was waving above the water. My dad was so embarrassed, my mom wanted to throw him out of the boat. But Marilyn, we get in the water, and, you know, she's looking around, and I go, oh, what's that? She's like, oh, you know, shut up and that. And she would always say, I just wish I could see bottom. Jesus said, come out with me in deep water where you can't see bottom. Come out and trust me out here. With our high dive series, there was a counsel. I started Googling stuff, and there's a counseling agency in South Carolina, and their counseling services diving off the high dive. And they said, you know, all of us have these moments. They're kind of seminal moments. And do you notice when you get in those moments, they said the what if start. What if? What if I belly flop? What if I miss the pool? What if? And they said, do you notice what ifs are never positive? Right? And that's kind of the mind thing we go through. And Jesus is challenging us to go deeper. Pastor Terry's email was fabulous if you read it. She talked about this short film. You've got to watch it. Go back to her email. Hit the link. I watched it. I'm going to show a few clips at Mosaic. It was in Sweden. These directors paid people who had never jumped off a 30-foot high dive, a tower. It's called the 30-meter or 10-meter tower. That's more than 30 feet, actually. I know my metrics. But it paid them $30, 67 people who'd never done that to see if they'd do it, and they film them up top. It is hilarious. It's all in Swedish, but the subtitles are great. There was a couple named Linus and Frida, and I made my wife watch it. We were just howling. And I said, you realize this is exactly how we left the corporate arena to go into ministry? You know? And the guy's like, I'm going to scream. And he screamed. And I said, yep, that was it. The only difference in that story was Linus was braver than me. He jumped first, and Frida followed. Terry jumped first, and I still was up there for a few minutes. But, you know, how do we do that? How do we go out into deep water? And why are we so afraid? Here's one of the reasons we're afraid. See, Hallmark tells us if you get close to God, it's going to be warm, it's going to be fuzzy, it's chestnuts roasting on the open fire. I was really at a Hallmark store a few weeks ago. I was thinking about this message, and they had something that during time, I hope you get closer to God. And it was a stained glass window. It was pastel. There was sunbeam coming through. And I'm like, you know, it may end up that way, but if you get close to the real God, if the real Jesus gets in your boat, not the one you want to be your personal assistant, but the one who created the stars and the heavens and all there is and tells us to take the plunge and go off the high dive and get deeper, it's terrifying. It is disruptive. Right? Look at Peter. Jesus gets in his boat and they go out in the deep water and he experiences the presence of who in which he's in. And you cannot hide in that presence. Everything about you, everything you spin to everybody else so they'll never see, the things you never post on social media because you're trying to make your life look shiny, he sees all that. You see all that. It's a mirror. And you're exposed. And what does Peter do? Oh, thank you, Lord, for getting in my boat. No, when Jesus got in his boat to preach, when Peter and them weren't in it, he said, look, I've got the best rabbi in town in my boat. But when Jesus said, no, you get in this boat with me, and we're going to go into deep water, Peter says, what? Get away from me, Lord. Get away from me. I'm a sinful man. You know, if you read in the scriptures, the closer you get to God, like I said, not that two-dimensional cardboard God that looks a lot like you and votes like you and hangs out with people like you, but the real God, the God that can, you know, argue with you, the God who can contradict you. If you don't have that God, it's not a real God. It's just a projection of your own heart. But you get to near that God, it's disruptive. If you read Isaiah 6, when Isaiah goes in the chamber and he meets the real God, read Isaiah 6, verse 5. What did he say? Woe is me, I cried. I am ruined. The common English version says, I'm doomed. The Hebrew word there is, I love the old King James, I'm undone. The Hebrew word is damam. You know what it literally means? To cease to exist, to be destroyed, to perish. I got close to God, Isaiah said, and I died. Isaiah 15:1 uses that word and said, I was laid waste and brought to silence. Peter, get away from me, Lord, for I'm undone. I'm ruined. You know, you remember, you know the story of Mozart. Remember Salieri, the great composer? And he got close to Mozart, and he died. And he perished. And if that just happens with a composer, how much more when we go close to God? Okay, so that's the problem. What's the solution? A couple things I see real quick. What's the way into the deep water? Peter found out it's the way of surrender. I like verse 5:5. It's right in the middle of that narrative, those 11 verses, where Jesus said, we're going to go out into deep water. And I love what Peter said. He bookends two important things with one negotiation. Master, we've worked all night long and have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I'll do it. Anybody raise kids? You know, thought fun. We're going to have our granddaughter later today. She's starting to learn those wonderful words, no and why. You know, and you tell your child that for a while, and hey, we need you to, can you go make your room and all that? And what's the answer? Why? Well, you know, we just wanted to eat. We may have people coming over. Why? You ever go through the unknown why? It's a little irritating, doesn't it? And at some point you say, why? See, the choir knows. You know, because I said so, right? And this is really interesting to me, because Peter has more reason to say why than a child, even a child. He's a fisherman. He understands it. He's like, wait a minute, hey, we've been out there all night. You're just telling me you know the spot? I mean, you're a rabbi. We're a professional fisherman. Like, do you have first century GPS? Do you have sonar? Do you have that thing you can put down and see aqua view of the fish? I mean, yeah, Lord, we've been there. We've done this. I've tried it. I tried that before. It didn't work. Is he going to put forward my agenda? Is he going to help me achieve my goals? See, when you talk to God like that, Jesus is your advisor. But he's not your Lord. And Peter, with no reason to do, says master. I love that term. You know that term is only used 6 times in reference to Jesus, all in the book of Luke. And all of them, when there's serious confusion or terror. Like when the storm came up and Jesus is sleeping in the boat. They didn't just say master, they said master, master. Right? The word is despotos, it means absolute ruler. You know, Jesus can be your advisor, but when you talk to him like that, he's your Lord, master over my problems, master over my situation, master over my finances, master over my family. Peter's basically saying, Lord Jesus, I have no reason to do this. Love my enemies, bless those who curse me, go the second mile with ungrateful people, give expecting nothing in return, forgive 7 times, Peter asked, like every day. No, Jesus said 70 times 7, which was an image of infinity. Lord, I don't see how this will help me. I don't see how this will advance me, but because you said so. That's faith. That's surrender. I've learned there's been a big difference in my prayer life between, Lord, tell me what you want me to do, and Lord, do whatever you want to do through me. The early Methodist John Wesley would have them pray this prayer every year. I'm no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Place me with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be put to work for you or set aside for you. Praise for you or criticize for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and fully surrender all things to your glory and service. That's surrender. That's the way to deep water. It's the only way to jump off the high dive. Last thing, the way to deep water is also the way of emptying. See, I've learned a principle with God. We move on full, right? When your light comes on in your car, I got this little Kia app right now. It's so cool. When I get down to empty, I can just hit my app and it says, you have 32 miles left. And I'll say, honey, we only got to go to 27. We can make it to the meeting, you know. We move on full. We get to say, God moves on empty. Read the beginning of the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. By definition, it was empty. And the Spirit of God moved. God has an awful tough time moving on full people. He said, those who are well don't need a physician. They're too full. But I didn't come to call the righteous. I called to come the empty. And when Jesus sees that these guys have empty nets and they've gone out of their empty boats, he gets excited and he moves in. See, I'm struck how that word empty nets sounds so much like emptiness. Augustine said there's a hole in all of our hearts that only God can fill. And we're always going to be anxious until they do. Okay, corny illustration. I'm going to be a magician today. No, I told my wife this morning, this is so simple it's embarrassing. And it's corny, and you're allowed to laugh at me and post about me on social media. I had this epiphany. I was out working in the yard. I was thinking about this sermon. And when I was out doing some work, right? You all wear these, right? When you work gloves?
Yes.
And thank you. One person works outside with me. Yes, okay. You all were looking at me like, I don't know, you know, it's not an iPhone. It's a work glove. And I was working on some stuff, and I'd been out in my backyard, and I'd been doing devotions earlier. It's just a weird thing. I was coming off the ladder, and I threw my gloves, trying to hit a chair. And one of my gloves, like this, it just jumped up on this devotional book I was reading. It was sitting there. And I thought, isn't that? This thing is designed, what, to help us lift. Right? It's knitted, it's padded. And I got to thinking, you know, if I say to that glove, why don't you pick up that devotional book? Why don't you start reading it? See, I told you this is really embarrassing, but it was my mind, it's my world, you wouldn't want to paint it. And I thought, you know, we get this glove, it's kind of like us, designed for good works, that's what it says. But I thought maybe the glove just needs some encouragement, maybe it needs to come to church on Sunday. Just a little inspiration. So I thought, okay, I can preach to the glove. Do you know Ephesians says, you are God's handiwork. You are made for good works. Now pick up that devotion. Nothing happens, right? So maybe it needs a little training. I thought about that. Maybe it needs to be discipled. Maybe it needs some one-on-one work. You know, glove, this is the thumb, and this is the finger, and just put them together. Maybe you need to go to ministry by strengths. I think you have achiever strength, and you can pick this thing up, right? That didn't work. And then it's maybe the glove needs some fellowship, right? Maybe it needs to go to a couples meeting. Maybe we just need more gloves around it, right? You know, like small groups. Maybe it'll get the thing. Maybe it needs a multicultural community, you know, and we'll try that. You know, it's still nothing, right? Maybe all it needs is commitment. Dang it, glove, bow your head, rededicate your life, lift your hand, I see you, come forward, get baptized. But then I realized, even though this glove is made for good work, we all are made for the supernatural work. But our natural selves can't do it. Ask Paul, who in Romans 7 said, all the good I am supposed to do, I can't do it. I do the very thing I don't want to do. See, the only way this glove works is if a living hand comes into that glove and possesses all parts of it. Are you getting the illustration? We all have the capacity for spiritual work. We all were designed for spiritual work. But unless we empty ourselves, what does Peter say later? He writes, humble yourselves before under God's mighty hand, that God may lift you up. We're created for this life. We just don't have the power for it. And we need to let Jesus get in our boat and live, fill us through the power of His Holy Spirit. Y'all didn't boo me or hiss. Okay? All right. You got that? How do you think the millennials are going to do with that next week? They're going to say, it doesn't work for me. It has to be on one of those printers that prints the glove. Anyhow. So if we confess, here's my last thing. If we confess to our spiritual emptiness, we can discover the power, His power, to come into our lives to bring purpose. Do you hear how the story ended? Don't be afraid. From now on, you're going to do something better. You know, Peter has this story happen to him two times. One time he says, depart from me, you're a sinful man. After the resurrection, he's diving in with everything he has, trying to get to Jesus. Do you notice in both those stories, Peter knows the miracle is never about the fish. It's never about the miraculous catch. It's always about him and his relationship with Jesus. And it's always about you. Don't be afraid. From now on, I'm going to give you a greater purpose. And you'll be catching people so they left everything and followed him. Close with this story. I read this recently. There's a commentator, you've probably seen her. She's a political commentator. She's floated on MSNBC and Fox News. And she was more real part of the Republican Party during the 2016 campaign. And she wrote a memoir recently. Her name's Terry Sheffield. And she wrote a memoir, it's entitled this, Motorhome Prophecies, A Journey of Healing and Forgiveness. And I had to jump on it, and I went through it. Terry Sheffield shared, politics had become my idol. They had become my idol. And she grew up in a very abusive religious home. It was an offshoot of Mormonism. Her father believed he was a Mormon prophet, and he was actually excommunicated by the Church of Latter-day Saints for heresy. She grew up with seven siblings in various motorhomes, tents, houses, and sheds. Carrie attended 17 different public schools. And when she took her ACT test, she said, our family lived in a shed with no running water in the Ozarks. All the children inherited trauma from their tumultuous family. Two of her siblings have schizophrenia. One was a brother who actually tried to rape her. Carrie has been hospitalized, she said, 9 times for depression, fibromyalgia, suicidal ideation, and PTSD. When she left home to go to Brigham Young, that's the only university she knew, where she would receive a degree in journalism, her dad declared that she was satanic and disowned her. As a student, she felt disillusioned. She stopped practicing Mormonism. She renounced it in 2010. She went on to Harvard and got her master's in public policies. For years, she assumed I would never return to God or any form of religion. And she writes this, I quote out of her book, I wrote this down. To fill the void, I threw myself into work, schooling, dating friends, and travel, all ultimate sources of meaning. None of it worked. Remember that God-sized hole? I worked as an analyst for major Wall Street firms, earning unthinkable sums for a girl from a motorhome. I launched a career in political journalism at outlets like Politico, The Hill, and The Washington Times. But ultimately, her career goals left her unfulfilled. It was during the 2016 election that she felt an existential crisis. She writes, I realized that when I lost faith in God, I had allowed politics to become a substitute religion. She built her career in politics, working on campaigns, a goal to be in the White House, CNN, MSNBC, Fox News, Fox Business. She even sparred with Bill Maher on Real Time. She wrote this, during this crisis of meaning, I felt distraught and adrift, so I turned to church, first to Redeemer Presbyterian in New York City, later to St. Thomas Episcopal. It was during a service that I encountered the scripture's answer to a career and political idolatry. It was in Mark 8, what does it profit you to gain the whole world? Or what will a person give in exchange for their soul? Studying Christianity again felt to me like uncovering buried treasure. I joined the Episcopal Church having been influenced by Presiding Bishop Michael Curry, which of us haven't been influenced by him. My baptism day, December 3rd, 2017, was the happiest of my life. A group of about 30 family and friends watched me vow to, quote, serve Christ in all persons, loving all my neighbors as myself, and to, quote, strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being. More than 6 years since my baptism, I enjoy a healthier relationship to politics. I still have strong convictions, which I don't hesitate to share, but I know God is far bigger than any puny human-made system. As I returned to my walk with God, I felt enveloped with a sense of peace that passed understanding. Carrie jumped off the high dive. Carrie went out into deep water, just like Carrie, just like Peter did. The question today is, will you? Will I? It comes by surrender. It comes by emptying. And it comes by saying, Jesus, okay, as much as it pains me, get in my boat. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Lord God, come, Holy Spirit, fill us. Give us the power that we don't have without you, that we might be able to, through the power of your Holy Spirit, do the works and live. We can't do it without your help. And the good news is, we don't have to. Thank you, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing as we close.
Back out into God's world, God's kingdom. I pray that we'll all reflect on how God is inviting us to go deeper, to take the plunge, to go off the high dive, whatever that looks like for us. And again, a simple way to do it is grab one or more of these signs, give them to friends, neighbors, family. Let's cover Cleveland with love and show a different kingdom. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.